Thank you. We resume business this afternoon with portfolio questions on government, business and constitutional relations. Question number one from Linda Fabiani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when it last held discussions with the Prime Minister.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Russell.
The First Minister spoke to the Prime Minister by phone on Tuesday afternoon, and the First Minister reinforced the Scottish Government position that Article 50 should be extended to allow time for a second EU referendum.
Linda Fabiani.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. And it's certainly the case, Presiding Officer, that a lot has happened even since Tuesday. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me when it is likely that there will be a further discussion with the Prime Minister about Scotland's future, whether he believes that the Prime Minister is in fact in control of events and listening to the increasing calls for an extension to Article 50?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say I see no sign that the Prime Minister is listening. She's not even listening to her own party, which is voting against her. I think this is a tragedy in terms of where this issue has gone. We are now within a fortnight of the expected date of Brexit, and there is no agreement and little sign of one. I think there's also a real democratic issue in a Prime Minister who keeps coming back to the House of Commons with the same issue. That is wearing people down. That is a government by attrition. It is not democracy. In all those circumstances, I would be happy, as I'm sure the First Minister would, to enter into substantive and meaningful discussion with the Prime Minister about how she might change the position she's in, change her red lines. This should have happened months, some might say years ago. It has not happened. And I don't think the Prime Minister is the type of person who can make it happen now.
Question number two, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what response it has received from the UK Government to the simultaneous debates of the Scottish Parliament and the Welsh Assembly that voted to reject the withdrawal agreement and a no-deal Brexit.
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say we've received no response from the UK Government. It's not even clear after the various fiascos of last night in the House of Commons, including the extraordinary spectacle of the Prime Minister yet again voting against what she had proposed, it's not clear if there's an agreed UK government position. And that's an absolutely extraordinary situation, with, as I say, little more than 2 weeks to go before the UK is due to leave the European Union. The views of both this Parliament and the Welsh Assembly have consistently been ignored throughout the Brexit process. And of course, large sections of Northern Irish opinion have also been ignored because of the way in which the Prime Minister has put herself in hock to the DUP. Meanwhile, the Prime Minister is still trying to deliberately run down the clock to a deeply damaging exit from the EU, but we will do everything we can to prevent that disaster.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and I share his frustration that a handful of DUP MPs have more sway over the future of the UK countries than the Scottish Parliament or the Welsh Assembly, and indeed the First Minister and the Parliament have been ignored in this. And does this not demonstrate the need for Scotland to go its own way as an independent country?
I do recall the very wise observations of the Leighton, great Donnie Stewart MP, the MP for the West Isles and former president of the SNP, when he observed that if the people of Scotland each got an opportunity to spend 30 minutes in the gallery of the House of Commons, they would be in no doubt about voting for independence. And we have seen repeatedly, again and again, in the Commons, how chaotic their system is and how chaotically they are led, or not led, frankly, by a Prime Minister who is a Prime Minister in name only. And part of that has been, as I've said, to put herself and her government in hock to extremists, but to the DUP and particularly to the European Research Group. These are people who will never be satisfied. They won't be satisfied with any resolution, and they certainly won't be satisfied until they have got their own destructive way for their own destructive ends. The Prime Minister has repeatedly been told by many people, including by the Scottish Government, that she should have been talking constructively to others. She's chosen instead to pander to the worst elements in her own party, and the consequences are there for everyone to see.
Neil Findlay.
Very disappointing that the UK government hasn't responded to the joint work that we did in this parliament with the Welsh Assembly, and I'm pleased that the government did engage in that initiative, and I hope we will work closely with our colleagues in Wales on other issues as well. has continued to work with them on Brexit. But will the Cabinet Secretary have a word in the ear of the First Minister and ask her to stop using the Government of Wales as one of her regular diversionary shields when she is in trouble at question time, when in fact we should be learning from the Government of Wales that's doing some tremendous work?
Secretary.
I have to say that my engagement with the Government of Wales is on the business of Brexit, and I've made it absolutely clear that that has been a constructive engagement and continues to be a constructive engagement. It does not prevent the Government of Wales or the First Minister of Wales criticising the SNP, as I indeed believe happened at the weekend at the Labour Party conference, nor does it inhibit the First Minister and others criticising the Government of Wales. But on this issue, and I think it is important to say this, on this issue, we have worked very constructively with that government, as we have worked constructively with Mr. Finlay and the Labour Party in Scotland, and our aim is the same. I would hope that the Labour Party would endorse and push for, publicly, a second referendum. That will help enormously, but we have worked well together, and I hope we'll continue to do so on this issue.
Question number three, and sorry, I should first of all say that question number three and question number eight are going to be grouped together. Question number three, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government how much of the £55 million it received in Barnett consequentials for 2019-20 to prepare for leaving the EU has been allocated and to what?
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, the £55 million has been distributed in its entirety across multiple portfolios. Particular consideration has been given to the areas that will be heavily affected by Brexit, namely the economy, transport, food and drink, medicines, agriculture and the rural economy. These portfolios are responsible for managing their preparations within their total budget.
Jackie Bailey.
I'm very pleased to hear the Minister's response, but last year's budget, he'll be aware, also included £37 million for the effects of Brexit, but I understand that only £27 million of that money was spent. None of that money went to Police Scotland, and I didn't hear any mention of them in his current list. Now, the Cabinet Secretary, or the Minister, sorry, will be aware that Police Scotland are reporting that there will be a significant risk if additional funding is not secured to provide for the recruitment of new officers to deal with some of the consequences of Brexit. The £55 million has been allocated on the basis of civil contingencies in the event of a no-deal scenario. So can I ask the Minister, firstly, whether the money is contingent on there being no deal, or whether we can keep it anyway, which would be helpful, and secondly, whether he will urgently consider making an allocation from this amount to Police Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me try and cover that as best I can. Of the £37 million, £27 million was allocated to specific Brexit-related activity in the Scottish Government and its agencies, with the remaining £10 million being spent by portfolios as part of the overall budget settlement. All portfolio areas have benefited from all of the EU consequences being allocated via the budget, but I have to say that none of the Scottish Government 2018-19 or 2019-20 EU consequentials arose as a result of increased UK Government spending on policing. However, of course, as with all other public bodies, dialogue continues with Police Scotland.
Question number eight, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the Scottish Government how much it has received from the UK Government to prepare for Brexit and how much of this has been spent.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, as I've mentioned earlier, there was a sum from last year, there's the sum of £55 million this year, and all of these sums have been or are being allocated.
I'm grateful to the Minister for that answer. The Chief Executive of Morrisons reported a 7% increase in the purchase of basic medicines and toilet paper yesterday. Tesco's and Marks and Spencer's have also increased their own orders of tinned goods. Can I ask the Minister whether he is stockpiling anything ahead of Brexit and what the Government's advice to consumers is ahead of leaving the EU? Should they take steps to stockpile the basics or not?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as a responsible government, we would not be advising people to stockpile, but what we are doing is putting considerable work into assessing the challenges that will be faced as a consequence of Brexit, particularly a no-deal Brexit, if that's where we end up. There's considerable work going on through the SCORE committee in conjunction with local authorities, for example. It's covering the full range of priorities that we would face. For example, we've covered the issue of access to boilers, for example. Medicines are, of course, part of that consideration. So I would assure the member that a great deal of work is going on to prepare Scotland insofar as we can for the consequences of Brexit, and we will continue to do that.
And Tom Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In his answer to Kezia Dugdale, the Minister stated that the £55 million had been made available this year from the UK Government. Can the Minister set out his views on how this amount compares to the loss of economic funding and the consequent economic damage Scotland will face for being dragged out of the European Union against its will?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, it is a drop in the ocean compared to the impact that Scotland is facing as a consequence of leaving the EU. And it's an impact that's being felt right across the board, the Scottish Government directly, local authorities, a multiple number of public bodies, and of course the private sector as well. So this is a very small proportion of what would be required to mitigate the impact of Brexit. Far better that we could find a way to avoid it completely.
Question number four, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment has made of the impact that Brexit will have on third sector funding.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, EU funding benefits Scotland's third sector very significantly. As a result of the UK Government's chosen route for exiting the EU, we will lose access to almost all of this. As yet, the UK Government has failed to provide any real detail on future funding arrangements. Scotland's third sector has told us that, in particular, the loss of structural funds without consultation and without a clear replacement is of grave concern. The UK Government committed to consulting on a shared prosperity fund by the end of 2018. It's disappointing that it's not been forthcoming and there's been no update to the devolved administrations. On the 5th of February, the Cabinet Secretary for Communities and Local Government wrote to the UK Government to seek an urgent update and reassurance that the concerns of Scotland's third sector will be properly considered. We await a response.
David Torrance.
I thank the Minister for that answer. A number of groups within my constituency have benefited over the years from EU funding, such as Fife Coast and Currentside Trust. The contributions made by these groups cannot be overstated, but this support to our communities is under serious threat. What assurances can the Minister give to third sector organisations all across Scotland that now have grave concerns about their future?
Minister.
The reality is, Presiding Officer, we can't offer any guarantees here because we are dependent on the UK Government. Should the withdrawal agreement be agreed in full, Scotland will continue to benefit from programmes and funding covered by the multi-annual financial framework, as it would if the UK continued to be a member state, at least until the end of this budget round in December 2020. In the event of a no deal, the UK Government has given guarantees for replacing EU funding with UK finance. We've committed to passing these guarantees on in full, provided we're given the means to do so, of course, and we'll continue to press the UK Government on how these will operate in practice. As I said earlier, it's deeply disappointing that the UK Government has yet to provide any further clarity on future arrangements for EU funding, and proposals made so far provide no certainty for the future. The shared prosperity fund situation is particularly concerning. I have to say, Presiding Officer, it's crucial that the UK Government urgently firms up the commitment to replacing all funding streams in full and that we receive our fair share of this to ensure that the decisions can be taken in the best interest of Scotland.
Thank you. Question number five, James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its plans for a future independence referendum have been informed by the Sustainable Growth Commission.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The case for independence has been informed by the way Scotland's interests have been consistently ignored and sidelined by successive Westminster governments, but particularly during the whole disastrous Brexit process. An anonymous UK government minister recently told the BBC that there should not be another independence referendum because, in his or her words, once you've hit the iceberg, you're all on it together. The Growth Commission was set up by the SNP, not the Scottish Government. But the evidence it presented shows that rather than hitting the iceberg, as James Kelly seems to prefer, Scotland can prosper as an independent country with the full powers of independence. The First Minister has made clear that the Scottish Government will set out its views on a future independence referendum when the position on Brexit is clearer. We believe Scotland's future should be in Scotland's hands, not under the control of Westminster governments people in Scotland did not elect.
James Kelly.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Is it not the case that the SNP Growth Commission, or should I say the SNP Cuts Commission, sets out a position where there will be year on year of cuts and uncertainty around currency, and that will pile agony onto local communities in terms of cuts and inequality? And therefore, would the Cabinet Secretary not accept that the government would be better explicitly ruling out another independence referendum and concentrating on the important issues for the country like providing proper public services, tackling inequality, and ensuring jobs and growth in the economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, that is what the Scottish Government has been concentrated on and will continue to concentrate on because we are very focused on making Scotland a better place to live and to clearing up the mess made by successive Westminster governments, Tory and Labour, of course. But I want to address this issue of what the Growth Commission actually said. The Growth Commission did not say what Mr. Kelly suggests it said. But actually, there have been, of course, years of cuts, years of austerity, years of confusion. And they have been brought about by the Labour Party and the Conservative Party and the Liberal Democrats refusing to back independence in 2014. So the recipe for continued chaos and confusion and cuts, and this is absolutely clear, is to continue to vote for either Labour or Conservative or Liberal. That is what will bring out the cuts. What will bring out prosperity and a better future is to choose the normality, the international normality of independence.
Neil Findlay.
In some of his previous writings on these subjects, the Cabinet Secretary didn't argue for independence. He argued for a new union, as I recall. And he also argued for educational vouchers, privatisation of the NHS and the privatisation of the civil service. And could he also remind us which currency he wanted in those days?
Cabinet
Secretary. I do really love Mr. Findlay's attempts. I really love Mr. Findlay. I really love his two things. His attempts to continue to essentially misrepresent something which he's only read, if even once. But secondly, the fact that nothing changes, apparently. You know, nothing changes year after year, decade after decade. Mr. Findlay may go on talking about the same old things in the same old way, and cheered on by the Conservatives, which is very significant, of course. This is the Better Together Alliance back again. The reality is, first of all, I refer Mr. Findlay to my regular answers on this point. I'm fascinated he still is interested in my career as an author. But secondly, I refer him to the reality of Scotland today. The reality of Scotland today created by his failure, the Labour Party's failure, the Tories' failure, first of all in government at Westminster, and secondly, their refusal to back the international normality of independence.
Adam Tompkins.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, in the light of that answer, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what is this week's plan for a currency for an independent Scotland, and how is it different from last week's plan?
Cabinet Secretary.
I really think the Tories are on rather dodgy ground about changed plans. How absolutely extraordinary. Those people who saw last night's farce being played out on television of a government that couldn't decide whether to vote against its own policy or not would regard what we have just heard from Professor Tompkins as a diversionary tactic. The policy of the Scottish Government is to have a modern, prosperous, independent Scotland. Scotland cannot be modern and prosperous when it is dragged out of the EU against its will and dragged backwards by either the Conservatives or Labour.
Question number six, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the progress of a European Union Legal Continuity Scotland Bill?
Cabinet Secretary Michael Ryan.
The Supreme Court's positive decision in the reference of the Continuity Bill has significant implications for the devolution settlement in Scotland. I've held discussions on the consequences of this judgment with representatives of parties right across the chamber on a number of occasions. I'm grateful for their input. A further discussion is planned next week. I hope that a consensus can be achieved, which would allow me to take a decision on how to proceed, which, of course, I would bring to this chamber.
Alexander Burnett.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the impartial and independent UK Supreme Court struck down the most contentious portions of his bill, a situation caused by the Scottish Government's misuse of emergency legislation powers to force through this legislation. So has the Cabinet Secretary taken any lessons on using these powers more sparingly and judiciously in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
You know, I would recommend that the member reads the judgment, not the opinion of the judgment from Professor Tomkins. Those are two very different documents. One of them is grounded in constitutional law and fact, that is the judgment of the Supreme Court. One of them is grounded in political prejudice, that is the one from Professor Tomkins. Now, it is up to him whether he does that. It does not enhance his reputation, I have to say, in the academic world, as I know from comments I've received from many people, because the reality of the situation is that the Supreme Court was utterly clear about the position. The bill, only in one very small... Presiding officer, I am trying to explain this even to Professor Tomkins, who seems keen to shout rather than to listen. In one very small part of the bill, there was an exception made. As far as the judgment was concerned, and Mr. Burnett doesn't seem to have read the judgment, so let me tell him this. As far as the rest of the judgment was concerned, the court was absolutely clear that the difference that was made was by the passage of a bill by the UK government after this chamber had approved the continuity bill. Now, I don't know whether they use this word in the grand surroundings of Aberdeenshire. We call that pookling. This was pookled by the UK Tory government, and the member should be ashamed of that fact rather than shaking his head and grinning. The thing to grin about in this is, unfortunately, that Scotland was cheated of its bill by pookling by the UK Tory government.
Question 7, Annie Wells.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to publish an up-to-date timetable for the introduction of legislation included in its programme for government.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding officer, the Scottish Government is committed to introducing all of the bills in the current programme for government ahead of the announcement of our next programme. The timetabling of new bills and those already in the Parliament is being impacted, of course, by the unwelcome requirement to divert resources to prepare for a no-deal Brexit. Individual bill timetables are therefore subject to continual review, and I'm discussing this with the relevant committees, conveners, on a regular basis. But can I say, Presiding Officer, I want to take this opportunity to recognise the work of the committees of this Parliament, who have responded superbly to the challenges that have been set this Parliament by Brexit.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Minister for his answer. However, only a third of the bills announced in the 2017 programme for government had progressed beyond stage one in 2017. So can I get the Scottish Government to commit to do better on their record this coming year?
Well, Presiding Officer, let's deal with reality here. The bills currently going through the Parliament that we expect to reach stage three by the end of 2019, Damages Bill, Age of Criminal Responsibility, Health and Care, Human Tissue, Management of Offenders, Vulnerable Witnesses, Fuel Poverty, yes. Census, South of Scotland Enterprise, Planning Bill, Climate Change Bill, yeah. Transport Bill. Yeah. Then we move on to the remaining Year 3 bills, which we anticipate being brought to this Parliament before the summer. Those would be non-domestic rates, disclosure, female genital mutilation, biometric data, consumer protection, electoral reform, electoral franchise, and family law. Proof, Presiding Officer, what it needed, that this is a government getting on with the day job.
Indeed.
Compare and contrast, Presiding
Indeed.
Officer.
Thank you very much, and that concludes portfolio questions. We're going to move on now to the next item of business, which is a statement by Richard Lockhead on update on the impact of Brexit on the Scottish further and higher education sectors. I would encourage any member who wishes to ask a question of the Minister to press their request to speak buttons as soon as they can.